Good evening. My name is Mary Watson, and I'm Executive Dean of the Schools of Public Engagement at the New School, and it's my pleasure to welcome all of you here tonight to this fantastic event entitled People Get Ready, John Nichols in Conversation with Sarah Jaffe on Technology, Democracy, and Inequality. Those of you who were here early and were listening to the first part of the music heard the Curtis Mayfield rendition of People Get Ready. There's a train coming. Don't need a ticket. Just get on board. I promised I was going to sing that, but I didn't actually sing it. But that's the reference of the title of the book tonight, and I think we're going to have a very exciting conversation about the content of this book. We're here also to celebrate a more than a decade-long partnership with the Nation Institute. We feature a lot of events in partnership with the Nation. We're always happy to host them there, and to give you a preview on April 18th, we'll welcome John Nichols, who's here tonight, back again, who's going to join Sarah Leonard and Bashka Sukara on an event called The Socialist Future, discussing the book The Future We Want, Radical Ideas for the New Century. So we welcome you back on the 18th as well. So tonight our discussion is about this new book written by Robert McChesney and John Nichols entitled People Get Ready, The Fight Against a Jobless Economy and a Citizenless Democracy, published by The Nation Books. Unfortunately, Mr. McChesney is ill, and we are sorry that he will not be able to join us to participate in the conversation tonight. We regret that. In this book, McChesney and Nichols argue that the United States needs a new economy and a revolution in technology to address the environmental and social problems we're facing and to rejuvenate and extend our democratic institutions. And based on a rich historical analysis and a deep understanding of the technological and social changes that are unfolding today, People Get Ready proposes a bold strategy to democratize our digital destiny before it's too late, and to unleash the power of the internet so that we can release the power of humanity. During the talk, we will have members of our staff distributing cards and pencils to submit questions for the Q&A period. And if you are on social media tonight, please hashtag PeopleGetReady and your comments that you're posting. Copies of the book are available here tonight on the side of this room, and John will be signing copies of the book after the event if you'd like to get his signature. And so now I'd like to introduce Katrina Vandenhoevel, editor and publisher of The Nation, who's going to introduce the speakers for tonight's event. Welcome. I was supposed to hold this up.
Thank you. It's great to be here tonight. Welcome. John Nichols gives me hope. He should give you hope. Not rosy optimism, but a belief that there is work worth doing, even though he's talking about the end of work. There's work worth doing to make this a more fair, just, peaceful country and world. He's the Nation's national affairs correspondent, but he is so much more. To call John prolific is an understatement. We often marvel, Nation Institute, Nation, Taya and I, many, how he does all he does. And with a generosity of spirit, a care for family, friends, and colleagues, he's the unofficial mayor of Madison, his beloved Madison, and he brings a politics of joy to many there and in all parts of this country. He is a compass. He guides me, he guides my Nation colleagues, its readers. He's a guide to savvy, humane, progressive thought, initiatives, strategies, electoral and movement leaders and activists, and his span of knowledge is remarkable. One day, he's writing about the latest media reform fight, the next a piece on the significance of David Bowie as a musician and humanitarian, the next on why the fight for Scottish independence is vital for democracy, and then about austerity globally and in Janesville, Wisconsin. And he's a fount of historical wisdom. Ask him about the 1932 election. Ask him tonight about what Charlie Chaplin meant to the work in this book. Ask him about the populist platform of, well, 1892, or the Labor Party leadership struggles, or why Tom Paine is relevant to our times. John's journalism, like The Nation's, and all of those who are reporting fellows at The Nation Institute, I hope provides an alternative to the backward-looking coverage that passes for political reporting and commentary too much today. But John doesn't just lament what he told me today he calls the dumb media beast. That's what he calls it. But John expands the range of discussion. He digs deeper. He looks ahead rather than trying to catch up. And he's always willing to enter uncharted territory, not recklessly,
not for the sake of disruption, but with a passion and purpose. There is a reason, Gore Vidal once said, of all the giant slayers now afoot in the great American desert, John Nichols' sword is the sharpest. This past weekend, brilliant reporter and editor Ben Bagdikian died. I don't know how many of you remember his work. Bagdikian had for decades sounded the alarm against media monopoly, against the danger of losing a vibrant local media. Today, many towns and cities are information deserts. On the shortest of notice, I emailed John. He was prepared to write in any case, but John wrote a brilliant piece about Bagdikian's importance and prescience. John and his longtime colleague, Robert McChesney, who couldn't be here tonight, built on Bagdikian's foundation. 2 decades ago, Bob and John launched the Media and Democracy Reform Movement, forming Free Press. I'm sure many of you know of their work. And Free Press's work, millions of allies, have forced the crisis of media into the national debate in ways that it wasn't for too long. In fact, Free Press, well, John and Bob launched the movement in the nation's pages in 1997, nearly 20 years ago. John loves to remind me that they submitted a 4,000-word manifesto. We cut it to 800 words. But hell, I mean, it launched a movement, which is as needed today as ever, as media malpractice gives lavish, obscene coverage to Trump while neglecting vital issues of our time and shamefully marginalizes Sanders and the issues he is driving into our politics at long last. Now, John and Bob have written a passel of books on their enduring themes: media, politics, democracy, elections. And John, of course, is the author of Dick, the Man Who Was President, Jews for Buchanan, and as a seventh generation Wisconsinite, his book Uprising, How Wisconsin Renewed the Politics of Protest from Madison to Wall Street, was a great nation book. So tonight we gather to celebrate John's, Bob's latest nation book, A Stirring Call to Arms. People Get Ready, the Fight Against a Jobless Economy and Citizenless Democracy. You heard about it a little earlier, but this is a necessary but unsettling read. It's not an attack on tech, but on dangerous, unchecked capitalism. And it's a reminder that once again, John Nichols takes us to uncharted territory during doing journalism that challenges, exposes, forces us to think anew. Just in time. Antonio Gramsci, someone Trump would probably haul in front of a committee if he had his way, once said at a different but eerily relevant and turbulent time in our history, quote, the old world is disappearing, but the new one is struggling to be born. And John is our guide to this new world. Join him. He is your compass. And I want to turn to someone who was my compass as a former nation intern, Sarah Jaffe, who's going to join John in conversation, lead John in conversation, who has a wonderful book coming this summer, I think. Necessary Trouble, America's New Radicals. Sarah Jaffe is the host of Belabored, a podcast at Dissent. She's a former reporting fellow at the Nation Institute. She is a former nation intern, and in that capacity, I am forever grateful to her or not for having introduced me to Twitter. She led me to do my first tweet. So welcome, and may this conversation begin. We need it. It's vital for our times and the future. Thank you.
Left or right?
On the left.
He's on. Hello, hello. I love this little setup here. This is great. So I thank you all for coming. Thank you to Katrina for that lovely, lovely introduction. I apologize for inflicting Twitter on you. And for all of you who have enjoyed Katrina's tweets over the years. So I think we're going to start off by, John just told me that he could summarize this book in a minute. I don't think I'm going to hold him to 1 minute, but we're going to let you do a little rundown about what's in this book, and then I will ask you some very difficult questions about it.
Pointed and thoughtful questions.
Pointed and
yes.
Thoughtful and difficult.
And I will start just very quickly by saying that Sarah and I have been comrades in struggle for a very long time. And Sarah and I are actually members. Somebody asked me, why do you always have Sarah introduce you when you're doing major events? And I said, well, we are members of a small sectarian grouping, which, you know, we actually required to support one another, as many of these small sectarian groupings on the left are. We are journalists who actually care about labor. And there's not a lot. It's not a crowded category, but I am so very honored to be with you tonight, because I realize that the next time we are on this stage, I will be interviewing you about your great book, and it will
be. I'm going to hold you to that.
I will be so excited to do it, Sarah Jaffe, who you should applaud with great wonder and delight. So I was at the Tucson Festival of Books the other day. And they draw about 150,000 people. It's an incredible event. I recommend it highly. And People Get Ready was selected as one of 10 books that had come out this year that they were highlighting. And so they had 10 authors stand on the stage for this huge crowd of people who had paid something or done something, and they had to explain their book in a minute. And so I was standing, Doug Brinkley was on one side of me, and then a whole bunch of people who had actually written books that, you know, are like super popular, like mystery novelists and children's books writers and stuff like that. And it was just fabulous. And the lady from Sesame Street, Maria, who has written a fabulous book. So it was just this totally cool thing, right? And so they said right before, oh, you got to do it in a minute. And I said, no trouble. Here's the bottom line. Our previous books that Bob and I wrote, and I'm very sorry Bob isn't here tonight, but he was overwhelmed by the thought of appearing before such a crowd. And just, but our previous books dealt with media and democracy and got a very respectful and pleasant reception in the United States. And they also were accepted by academia and blah, blah, blah. But weirdly enough, in Europe, people actually thought this might be relevant to policymaking. Unlike in America, where it's just like, oh, it's interesting to talk about media and democracy. Those are esoteric, fascinating topics. But in Europe, they actually thought, this is important. So we started getting invited to go to these incredible international conferences. And I want to tell you, the mineral water is fabulous. And everybody wears these really great suits. And there's a lot of security and swans. And so we're at these conferences, and we're talking about the future, and they would let me say a few things about democracy or media or something. And, you know, I would then, of course, having said my piece, which, you know, was greeted politely, sit back and listen to everyone else. And we were with the CEOs of major companies, we were with, heads of think tanks, really the people who are at the heart of debates about the future of not just this planet, but the people who live on it. What they will do for a living, how they will experience what comes next. And what fascinated me was they were all talking about how many jobs they were going to eliminate. And they actually had these fabulous screens where they would talk about whole industries, and they would flash up and say, well, today, to build a car, you would need this many people. But as we move through the next stages of digital progress, we will be able to build that car with a handful of robots and one guy doing this. And then they were talking about, it used to take 60 people to bring a ship into a port. It can now be done by one guy pressing a button. And they kept talking. It's interesting, it was always a guy. But the bottom line was, we kept eliminating. And I thought to myself, this is a very robust conversation. And then I would go to these other conferences. And it was this robust conversation. It was this incredibly engaged, focused conversation about a future where there were fewer and fewer jobs, and where the jobs that remained sounded like really not so great. Like you got to like take your private car and troll around the streets of big cities looking to see if anybody wanted to pay you to give them a ride. Or take an apartment in your, I know this is unimaginable that this could happen, but take an apartment, and like maybe you have a room in your apartment, you can rent it out to people who are like traveling to the town. And it's like all these things of, like where you would cobble together a life off the scraps of what, once was a society. And I thought to myself, this is interesting to me because I cover politics in America and I watch how the media covers issues. I watch what politicians say, and I'm struck by the fact that nobody is talking about this. Like our political, this is like a really big deal, right? I mean, sort of like a jobless future, or maybe not jobless, but really like not so great job future and a lot of other problems, and nobody's talking about it. And I thought, you know, this might be a good idea for a book. And then I came back, Bob and I were working on another book, and I started talking to him about it, and he said, this is so weird. I was just in Norway doing a conference, and that's all anybody was talking about. And so, long story being short, we scrapped the book we were working on. And we decided to write a book about the danger of a jobless economy and a citizenless future. It's not that we fear technology. We love technology. We are marinated in it. We use it all the time. However, what we fear is that our technological future and our digital and automation changes that will take place, that are taking place, that they will be handed down to us from on high by the CEOs of multinational corporations, by the heads of think tanks, and by tech utopians who fantasize that somehow we're going to be able to work this all out by developing a new app. There isn't an app to get us out of this thing. This is the bottom line reality. And it is a pure fantasy to believe that in a capitalist society, you would develop technologies that allow you to eliminate labor and then come up with some new way to create more jobs. That's not going to happen. It's illogical. And if we recognize that, then we get to the core of the book, the simplest core. And that is, why don't we say, cool, that's excellent. The technology was supposed to free us from drudgery. It was supposed to give us better, wholer, more wonderful lives. That's what Tesla promised. That's what Einstein promised. That's what Edison promised. Nobody who ever was inventing stuff said, oh, this is going to really make your future awful. No, they said it's going to make your life better. And what we suggest is that the change is coming. We're in the thick of it right now. It's already happening. And it is time for us to move up to that table, push some of these CEOs and think tank folks and tech utopians aside, put our chair right there. And let's just say, you know, our boots are a little muddy and our hands are maybe a little dirty, but let's put them down on the table and say, you know what? I would like to be a part of this discussion. I would like to be a part of deciding what kind of future I have. And if there's a great deal of wealth and progress and benefit to come from technological progress, I want a piece of the action. And so that's what we say. People get ready. Come on. There is a change coming. This train's coming through. You better get on board. But don't get on board as a passenger. Let's elbow our way up front and become the engineers.
So one of the books that you did not write with Bob, which unfortunately I'm going to start with because unfortunately, he's not here.
We ditched him so we can talk.
Is this book, this little book that you wrote a few years ago called The S Word. And, you know, I was reading this book and thinking about that one and thinking about a conversation I had with Shama Sawant not that long ago, who's, of course, Seattle's socialist city council member. And she said, you know, I don't think people are scared of the S word anymore. I think people are scared of the C word now, of capitalism. And so reading this book, I've read a lot of your books. Why is it now that we can talk about capitalism this openly?
It's an outstanding question, my friend. And
you have to say that.
No, look, it was funny. This afternoon, I try every day to accept an interview on right-wing talk radio, which I, of course, get all my information from. And so today I was doing an interview on right-wing talk radio. And so the guy goes, you know, what is it about this Bernie Sanders phenomenon? Do these kids not know about socialism? And he's like, you know, the most evil thing in the world and stuff like that. And I said, do you know, I blame Sarah Palin. Because Sarah Palin took a moderate Democratic president, Barack Obama, who I happen to think is going to be remembered very, very well for a lot of the things he did, but he's certainly not a socialist, not a radical. And Sarah Palin called everything he did socialist. It's just like constantly. We're going to do weatherization. We're going to require you to get new windows. Socialism, right? And the fact of the matter is, I think actually America listened. Now, mind you, that was not a wise move. But I think we all listen to Sarah Palin and Sean Hannity and Newt Gingrich and all these other people say that, you know, anything that was minimally good or humane or decent was socialist. And I think a lot of people said, oh, okay, I got it. You know, it's that the alternative to stuff that we think is really awful would be the S word. So that's separate from the economic stuff we're going to talk about. I think that the right wing in America did the best education lesson ever on behalf. I mean, Eugene Victor Debs, step aside, bro. You know, I mean,
or Debs.
They literally did this. And I think it took. Now, separately from that is the reality of what's going on. The reality of what's going on is that people are seeing what is true about capitalism happen on a daily basis. And it is unsettling them in profound ways. I think the beginning of it is very easily traced to 2008, when they melted down the global economy, right? And our reaction to it was one of the best lessons ever as regards how an uncontrolled and irresponsible capitalism might respond, right? I mean, if you were going to take, what would the textbook example be? I don't know. If you melted down the global economy, if you literally created a scorching crisis, what would you do? Oh, how about give a whole bunch of money to the people that did it, right? Literally take billions, hundreds of billions of dollars and give it to the bankers, right? Because they'll fix it. And of course, they didn't. And
shocking.
They haven't yet. And so we ended up, I think this was a profound lesson that even now our political media and even, you know, economic elites don't begin to understand that the American people actually pay attention. They actually are, because it's sort of their lives. And they saw this happen, and then they saw massive unemployment, right? They saw President Obama do a small stimulus, which was actually to the good, but they recognized that they weren't the first priority. And I think that was a profound lesson. Remember, if you are a kid at a Bernie Sanders, if you're a young person at a Bernie Sanders rally today, let's say you're 20 years old, your conscious memory is of a time in which multinational banks got bailed out, which wealth was redistributed upward at a massive level, and which you saw thousands of factories close when we were told, not all because of, you know, but we were told we saved the auto industry, and yet factories in your town closed, right? We saw all this happen, and you're sort of like, there has got to be an alternative to this. And I think that socialism is no longer feared because capitalism is seen as something jarringly bad, you know, really unsettling. And the weirdest thing is that I think the true questioners of capitalism are not at the Sanders rallies. They're at the Trump rallies. And these are not, it's not because they're on the left. They would clearly identify themselves on the right. But this is one thing that's important to understand about this year, and we write about this a lot in the book. Our media doesn't talk about the changes that are taking place. They are radical changes. Our candidates don't talk about it, by and large. Certainly our mainstream candidates do a lousy job of talking about it. And then you have candidates who are seen initially as on the fringe. What does Trump say? Make America great again. He's saying to a 58-year-old guy whose auto factory was closed, who retrained for a job in a warehouse, now that job is being replaced by a robot, and he's seeing these changes come in real time. And for that person, again, means to go backwards. Take me back to someplace safe. Take me back to a place where I can live where I was, at least for until I can retire, right, or make it through. And it's going to take me a lot longer to retire because they gave all my money to the banks after they crashed the economy. So that person there is questioning capitalism. They just don't know they're questioning it. And they are being led astray in the classic model, right, by blame somebody else. The kid or the young person at the Sanders rally is in much the same circumstance, except they grew up marinated in the technology, and I think they're a little better at recognizing what the future is going to look like. They're not as freaked out by today as they are by what comes next. But the fact is that if you go and you really travel, and I have, these folks, this is what they're talking about. They're talking about the failure of capitalism. It's just they don't use that term, but that's the subject that's in play.
So from one failure to another, because your book is about two big failures, right? Your book is about the failure of capitalism. Your book is also about the failure of democracy. And, you know, I used to joke back in the good old George W. Bush days that the way to actually understand what was being proposed was to substitute the word capitalism whenever George Bush said democracy. And I forget what the other one was. But, you know, and so we've been told for a very long time, and I remember this from, you know, ye old 1990s, that capitalism was the most democratic system ever. And not just in the Cold War era, but in literally in the 1990s when, you know, investing in the stock market was equal to democracy. And so it seems like one of the cases that you're making in this book is actually not that capitalism and democracy don't work well together, but that literally at this point, the capitalism that we live under is fundamentally incompatible with democracy.
Well, let me put it in a very similar way, but to say that capitalism cannot be good without democracy, and neither can socialism, right? I mean, the fact of the matter is, it is the lack of democracy that hands our power away to somebody else without any kind of return on it. And the crisis in America is that we tell ourselves we have a functional democracy. We certainly do not.
Who tells us, John? Who tells us?
Oh, you know what? The fact of the matter is, we do. We, the people, actually still have immense faith in this thing. And it's a wonderful thing. I see it all the time. You know, not everybody, but a lot of people actually believe that somehow that's the way to fix stuff, right? And what they don't recognize is the extent to which we have structurally created barriers to it working. And so you end up with, yes, immense numbers of people kind of extracting themselves from the process. I'll give you the example. What is the measure of a successful democracy?
Fair elections.
That's an interesting one. Not the right one, though. Love you, though. No, but I tell you, I'm going to give you a better measure. Trust me on it. Okay. What's the measure? Who's got it?
Lack of poverty.
There you go. All right. That's getting close. That's a good. Anybody else? Lack of crime. I'll give you that. You mean crime at like corruption or? Yeah. Okay.
Got one over here.
Oh, getting interesting there. Here you go. Number one, its simplest measure is participation. Does everybody think it's worth being a part of it? Do you want to actually, you know, jump in the game? And do you think something's going to come of this? Well, in America, we've actually had an election on democracy, right? On whether our democracy works to a level that people would say, yeah, I want to be a part of that. And in presidential elections, about half of us, we do a little better in a good election season, but roughly half of us don't vote. Or are barred from voting, or are undermining their efforts to vote, but huge numbers of people don't vote. And where you get to the real stuff, the real meat of the matter, the people that make day-to-day decisions about your lives, down in state elections and local elections, you know, local elections around this country are in absolute crisis. The turnout levels are so bad, so small, that it's like barely notable. I mean, this is a big, big deal. And it's exactly what Ben Bagdikian predicted in 1997 in one of his intros to media monopoly. Ben Bagdikian said, if you start to cull out local journalism across this country, if you close newspapers, if you close down newsrooms, if you keep cutting down the flow of information and giving people a decent amount of information at the top level, but nothing about where they live, right, they will slowly begin to participate less and less and less. Do you know, I cover politics for a living. I go across this country. Do you know what people say to me all the time? They say, these are people who are involved in politics. You know, they say, our number one problem is no one anymore knows who their city council member is or who their school board member is or when the election is. And I say, well, yeah, but people were always imperfect. They said, no. It used to be an election, every local election, it was sort of a festival. It was announced in advance. There was a theater that went with it. There was all sorts of reality. As we have changed our media system in this country, we have done all sorts of things that extract people from the process. And this gets to this guy's thing, which is a really important thing. In a good democracy, in a functional democracy, people say, oh, I got a problem. I need to solve this problem. Now, if you're very, very rich and you have a problem, in this society, you have a lot of ways to solve it. You can buy your way out of it. You can buy a politician. You can shape the policy debate. All sorts of opportunities. But if you've got nothing or almost nothing in this society, your ways of going up and changing things, of addressing it, seem very, very limited. We ask ourselves why turnout is so low among certain groups in society. I would suggest to you an analysis that says one of the reasons their turnout is so low is because they genuinely don't believe that they can affect any change. And why is turnout so high among wealthy folks? Wealthy folks do tend to vote. Because this is a fun, it's like icing on the cake. You've bought the politicians. Now I think I'll actually, yeah, sort of like close the deal. I'll vote for them too. But the fact of the matter is, we are in crisis as a democracy. We should understand that. And the measure of the crisis this year is the fact that the most successful political message of this year is, I'm against them all. And I hear this wonderful thing. Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders are debating themselves, debating with one another, about who's more establishment, right? And Hillary Clinton say, well, Bernie Sanders, he's served as a mayor and he's been in Congress and stuff like that. So he's part of the establishment too. And it's this notion that you have to find some way to say, even the 74-year-old Democratic socialist from Vermont is too much a part of the establishment in America. That's last stage politics, right? That's not the start of something new. That's the end of something old. That is trying to tell people that the best response to the crisis is to believe that everything's what they don't like. The best response to the crisis is to think about why people don't believe democracy works for them, and why it's so relevant to this book is that we are coming toward a moment where our only way out is great big democracy. We talk way too much about big data, big business, big money. We talk way too little about big democracy. And I will promise you this, if we don't have big democracy in this country very soon, we will be the feudal serfs of corporate capital.
Those of us who aren't already. So you kind of took the wind out of my sails talking about Ben Bagdikian and the media monopoly and this, you know, I'm sitting here, I actually am going to give a shout out to Andy Mendelsohn, who has taught me in journalism school and had me reading Nichols and McChesney, and also Ben Bagdikian, and also many, many other wonderful people that made me think about. Yeah.
We actually have a ton of people in this crowd who actually try to fix things. So, you know,
yeah, exactly.
You understand, we're not here to criticize you.
Yeah. But so.
Just to arm you to get out
one
there.
One of the things, and we'll return to more of the problem soon, but one of the things that you're arguing in this book to try to fix things is that we need to rebuild the infrastructure of democracy. And media, of course, is one of those things. Some people in here have probably read your previous books on the subject.
Well, we're talking, you know, we're doing an interesting walk here where we're telling you about a lot of the problems we have before we talk about the core problem, yeah, which is good. And then as we talk about how we get out of this, because this is a happy story. But this is the interesting thing about America. Thomas Jefferson was an incredibly imperfect president. And he's frankly an incredibly imperfect guy.
Yes.
You know, all men are created equal, problematic even there, because, you know, not everybody's a guy. Problematic also because you had a little bit of you seem to have a blind spot as regards
all
the slavery issue. So I'm not here to tell you Jefferson was the greatest thing since sliced bread, but I will tell you this. Jefferson thought a lot about how the American experiment might improve. I take my lessons about Jefferson from Martin Luther King Jr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, you know, we look to Jefferson not for what he did always, but for what he told us we could do. And this is one of the most interesting things that Jefferson said. He said that one of the worst things you could do to the next generation is to lock it into a constitution from a previous generation. To say that, you know, you must live your life under the set of rules developed by people who treated illness by bleeding themselves. And, you know, who accepted human bondage. And, you know, who literally traveled, you know, by foot because they had no other means of transportation. With all due respect, some things have changed since then. And yet we are locked into a political system and a political structure that still responds to rapid 21st century change with all sorts of barriers to making any kind of response functional and quick and wise and inclusive. And so we end up with this situation. I've always believed the story of America is the story of expanding democracy. It's a wondrous story. I mean, the people in this room, if you had a congressional election at the founding of this country, the people in this room would have been sufficient to choose. You'd be the wealthy planters who had gathered in a room in Williamsburg, Virginia to choose, or some town in Virginia down a little south of there, to choose between James Madison and James Monroe. And of course, the women couldn't vote. The people of color couldn't vote. In some cases, some places,
John.
Religious minorities couldn't vote. And certainly poor people couldn't vote, right? So you had everybody on the outside looking in. And they say, the histories of that time, they say that when an election was held, you would hear a cheer go up from the people outside if somebody they liked got elected. And they actually were engaged enough to watch it. They were full-on spectators, politics was a sport, and you were very, very engaged, and you actually had favorites, right? So it's not like these are stupid people. These are not like these are disengaged people. It's not like these are people that aren't a part of things. It's just they're not allowed to have any say. Well, we built beyond that, right? We opened things up. We brought more people in. But what I would argue is that in the last 50 years, we, you know, where we actually started to achieve something akin to full democracy in this country, then we started to erect a whole new set of barriers. And it's not just voter ID laws or all the other things that we talk about so much, which are completely legitimate concerns. And my friend Ari Berman's written a brilliant book about, you know, trying to renew the Voting Rights Act and all sorts of struggles there. It's not just money in politics. Bob and I have written books about money in politics and dollarocracy and these things. These are all relevant. But we have fundamental structural flaws that make democracy not function in America. And we have people in the room here tonight who've worked on some of those structural flaws and tried to address them. And what I would suggest to you is, this is huge stuff. We write a lot in the book about when this country was still young and when this country still believed, in the 1940s and the 1960s, 1970s. And in those days, conversations about democratic infrastructure were everywhere. People were talking about democratic infrastructure all the time. Franklin Delano Roosevelt gave his speeches about, you know, literally, you know, a second Bill of Rights. And he talked about literally how you would make democracy work. And do you know what he said? We got to have economic democracy along with political democracy. Because the great crisis of our times in his era was that decisions about the economy, decisions about our economic life, had been pulled away from the people. And thus, they were being made on high by elites. Roosevelt said of those elites, I welcome their hatred. I'm ready to take them on. The people loved him for that. Now, it happened when Roosevelt outlined a second Bill of Rights, he didn't say that democracy was simply about, you know, having elections. He said democracy was about having the resources, the capacity in your life, the job, the work, the housing, the health care, all of these other things that freed you to participate fully and to be fully engaged in our political life. And he said these were barriers too. It's wonderful when you study where Roosevelt was at. And you know what the interesting thing is? We took him seriously. And so as we move forward in the 50s and the 60s, what you saw was expansion of democratic participation, but you also saw addressing huge issues. The poverty of the elderly with Medicare, the poverty of, you know, so many folks with Medicaid, the war on poverty itself, influenced by Michael Harrington. Michael Harrington walking around the White House. A. Philip Randolph, one of the great socialists in American history, you know, sitting in the Oval Office with the President of the United States. People really talking about radical changes in our economic life to make real our politics, to make our politics consequential. It got so far. We got so close. And then power said, hold it, this thing's getting out of control. We write in the book about Lewis Powell's memo, the famous memo, where Lewis Powell talked, he said to wealthy people as a corporate lawyer, said, look, you know, we've got to get involved in politics. We have to start, you know, asserting our wealth, or the next thing you know, people like Ralph Nader and Jesse Jackson and, you know, all these radicals and all these activists, they're going to start guiding our country. And do you know what one of the things that influenced Lewis Powell to be so concerned? He was from Virginia. He was very influenced by the ads on television that said smoking was dangerous for you, and then the end of tobacco advertising. And he and other people said, look, if you can force companies to stop advertising for stuff just because it kills them, the next thing you know, they're going to be saying that we got a right to health care, we have a right to food, or we have, you know, that we're human beings, everybody's a human being. We got to fight against that. We got to do something about that. And we have seen over the last 40 years a diminution of democracy in America. The problem is now we are at a point where our democracy is not sufficiently vibrant and functional to deal with the change, the radical economic changes that are coming our way.
So you bring me to the robots and the algorithms and the iPhones that we're both sitting here next to. And so, yes, are you taking selfies? Okay. I was just going to make sure he's not, you know, we can leave you to take yourself.
It's illustrating the reality of this, you know, that this is something we've actually come to understand in our lives. Just to give you an example of how much it's changed our lives. I was at an incredible conference in Europe, and I was interviewing the head of Oxford Center on Artificial Intelligence. And the debate was about whether we were going to have to genetically alter human beings in order to have them keep up with computers, right? And have them keep up with the automation. This is a very lively debate in, again, when the people who are powerful actually get together, they talk about stuff like this. So we're in this debate, they're having this conversation, and the guy, and this guy, really smart guy, says, he says, no, you're actually not going to have to, we're not going to have to do that. Because, you know what we didn't realize this at the time, but instead of altering people internally, what we did was we just extended their arms. And we gave them this little device that they hold on to, like their life depends on it. And we run all the data and everything through it, and they kind of live in it. And so it's going to work out that way. That's just another way to look at the alteration of the human being.
We're all cyborgs now. Yep. I'm just going to note, though, that the phone that you're waving around here is in a little leather thing that says book.
Yeah, yeah. I'm fighting the good fight here.
It's right. But so one of the things that people do when they talk about how we're all doomed because the robots are taking all of our jobs is they talk about it like this is inevitable and that there's nothing we can do about it and that it's not a political process. So, and one of the first things that you say in this book is, no, this is all about power. So, John, explain to everybody that the robots are not inevitably going to ruin our lives.
Well, the robots are coming. That's the important thing to understand. And this is, you know, we should... I know you're super smart people, and we're in New York City, and you know it's not like where I hang out. And so I realize that you guys know a whole bunch. You even proving my Midwesternness because I refer to you as guys, the generic Midwestern term. Well, guys is the generic Midwestern term for humanity.
I live in the South, so we say y'all.
Y'all. Well, but I know you're really bright, and you know about all this
gender
stuff.
Neutral.
But this is an important thing to understand. This is a really important thing to understand. Everybody see Time magazine last week? The cover was on the driverless car. And the big thing, the driverless car is coming. It's arriving. And it was a very good piece, well done, and very detailed. And I've been dealing with the driverless car a lot recently. And what I can tell you is, it's real. They are on the roads around us. There are experiments going on where people who are visually impaired feel their way around the car, open the door, get in, say where they want to go, and the car takes them there. And there are cases, the Google folks did this incredible thing where they went to a senior center where the people were like everybody's over 90. And they got these wonderful ladies and they said, well, do you want to try a driverless car out? And they're like, sure. And so they put them in the front seat and they have a camera on them and they're driving around San Francisco, right? At like, you know, on the freeways at 60 miles an hour. And they are just like my mom and her friends. They're looking right at each other talking as the car just whizzes through the town. And they're like going, oh, look at this, you know? And here's the bottom line. It's great. It's really cool because they don't crash. The car itself is a computer. And so it takes in data. If somebody swerves in front of you, that car takes that data in and updates itself so it knows what to do when cars swerve in front of you. It constantly improves. And do you know what the driver's car never does? Try to tweet while driving.
Are you sure?
You can't. And this is the interesting thing. The driverless car is going to come so fast, and it is going to become such a part of our lives that they're now already in legislatures across the country changing the laws to clear the way for it. We're way down the track. This is fully real. And it's going to come even more quickly in commercial applications. That Uber isn't going to, you're not going to have all these people driving for Uber 10 years from now. Uber is already employing the top scientists on driverless cars. Their plan is to put driverless cars on the road, get you addicted to the app, and then they've got this whole infrastructure for the 21st century. It's very smart. It's very good. This is where we're headed. It's not a debatable point. There's only one minor problem. In states across this country, not everyone, but quite a few, the top job for men is driving. The top job for men in many states is driving. You drive a truck. You drive a tractor. You drive a forklift. You drive something someplace. And it's a really interesting job because you don't have to have a lot of education, but you have to be responsible. You have to show up on time. You have to have skills. You implement those skills. You deliver something for society. It's a big part of what people do. So what happens when the driverless vehicle is fully implemented? You say, well, there's an app for that. They'll do something else. We actually had somebody today say, well, yeah, but all those drivers, they'll become retrained to make those vehicles work. Well, that's a pretty inefficient new system if every single vehicle has its own mechanic, right? That's the answer you get from these people. No, you're going to displace gazillions of people. Well, millions. And the fact of the matter is, when we look at that, do I say get rid of the driverless car? No, not at all. But what I do say is, what are we going to do with those people? And I'm not the only one saying it. We open up our book with Eric Schmidt from Google, speaking at Davos. And Eric Schmidt said, in his keynote at Davos 2 years ago, roughly 2 years ago, said, you know, this is the big issue of the 21st century. This is the next 20, 30 years, we're going to have to be talking about this stuff, because what we're going to have to do with all of these people, you know, there's studies now that show that 45 to 50% of the jobs we have today won't exist. We will automate our way out of them. And is everybody here familiar with the concept of Moore's Law? Moore's Law. Moore's Law is a basic concept. It just says, we imagine technology, right? We imagine progress, but we can't really fill in all the blanks. We don't dot the I's and cross the T's. And so when we imagine it, we have this sort of like, you know, where's my jetpack kind of future, right? And then we fill in the blanks till we get to the jetpack. Well, in the 1960s, we had the best research talking, thinking about automation. Because everybody in the 60s and early 70s, we read about this book, they could imagine the future. But it wasn't, the blanks were filled in. And so people said, oh, okay, that's not really going to happen, is it? Right? We're not going to have jetpacks, and we're not going to have driverless cars, and we're not going to, so we all kind of went to sleep. And we said, okay, we're going to live. And we started to imagine that changes that took place were taking place just kind of by chance and stuff like that. We didn't realize that across that period, the technological progress was coming. It was advancing. And we hit the Moore's Law pivot, you know, some people say a couple of years ago. And under Moore's Law, the concept is when you get beyond the imagining to the actual implementation, suddenly you're going like this, and then you go like this. The technology becomes usable in all sorts of forms. That's what power is talking about right now, the application of technology in all sorts of industries. And as that happens, we're going to have tremendous numbers of people displaced. And they're not going to be, if we don't have a plan for how to deal with that, and it's going to be a multi-tiered plan with a lot of responses, we're going to have a lot of pain, tremendous pain. And just one last element on it, which is, I know that somebody always says, well, but you see, Henry Ford. That's always the answer. The answer is always Henry Ford, because see, Henry Ford, he was building his cars, and then he had to pay people and employ people to buy his cars, right? That was always, that, you know, you had to have an economy where people had jobs and had, you know, something functional. Well, I'm sorry, now we live in a quarterly economy, right? Most of our visionary thinkers, if they think a year ahead, they're getting a lot of credit, right? Our economy is set up not to worry about what happens to people a year from now or 10 years from now. It's immediate gain. And so that implementation of technological change keeps coming very rapidly. And here's the other thing that power figured out. It's a genius. It's actually an incredible thing. What they figured out is we're incredibly industrious and we love to work. We love to work too much. It's unhealthy. We kill ourselves by working too much. And they know that as you reduce the number of jobs, as you reduce the number of opportunities, and even as you reduce the amount of wages, they know from the last 40 years that our response will be to get up earlier, work harder, stay later. We will cobble together lives out of the remains of a economy where there really were jobs that were structured in a way that we understood them. We'll do the Uber driving, we'll do the Airbnb, we'll do the gigs, right? And we'll work ourselves really hard for a whole lot less for a long time. And you know what the weird thing is? You know why we'll work so hard? So we can buy the next phone. And so the people making these changes they talk about it at conferences, but they don't fret about us. They're not gonna worry about us. We have a quote at the start of the book from Lord Byron, back in the days of the Luddites. Lord Byron, who's the one leading figure in Great Britain who stood up for the Luddites when they tried to wreck the machines because they did not want the technological change that was going on. It's a wrong response, but it was an honest, sincere response of craftspeople who had decent lives and decent jobs and did not want to move to slums and work in dark, satanic mills. And what Blake said, and I'll paraphrase, was it took him a long time to realize that the hard work of the industrious poor was of no concern when weighed against the enrichment of a wealthy few. This is the way to understand technological progress. There's not somebody at the top sitting around worrying about you. You have to bring yourself into the process if you want to have a future where those changes that take place will redound well to your life, will actually play out in a decent way in your life.
So then what? Come on, you can't just say all that.
But
we have to talk about all of this as if it's not just doom, because I see a lot of people out in the audience going, well, now you're ruining my life.
This is my favorite part.
Now I'm terrified.
No, it's my favorite part. It's where, you know, we've taken, it's sort of, I came up in rock and roll, right? And so as you know, you got to kind of like, you take the downbeat, you know, you kind of bring it down a little bit, and you bring it way, way down. Just like Al Green talks about in Jesus is Waiting. And, you know, he says, you're going to bring it way, way down. And then you start to come on up. Well, you know what the come on up is? History. History always sees us through. It's our best friend. The only way to understand the future is to understand the past. This is not some philosophical construct. It's practical. And here's what we studied in the book. We wrote about all the technological changes. We talked about all with all the CEOs. We weighed all the reports. It's all in there. And it's really like jarring and wild and fun to read. By the way, the book makes a fine holiday gift. But we wrote about kids who are actually now sending away for a microchip, cutting their finger open, programming the chip, and then putting it in their finger, putting a bandage around so it's sealed up, thousands of kids across this country, so that they can have a leg up in dealing with computers, that they can start computers, open things, and do all sorts of stuff with a chip they have implanted in themselves. This is happening, right? So we write about all this stuff, and everything we looked at didn't give us a way out. So then we went back to the Luddites. Right? And this is the thing about, has anybody ever gone on vacation to Britain? Yeah. Did you ever go to like a village? Yeah, like a little village with thatched roofs and a church and a churchyard and stuff like that. It was pretty nice. I will bet you some of you who went there, or maybe even folks who just saw it in a picture, right? You thought, hey, you know, if things work out for me, I might like to live in a village like this with a thatched roof and a churchyard and all this cool stuff. That's where the Luddites lived. They lived in the villages of the north of England. They did not live exemplary, perfect lives. It was, you know, nasty, brutish, and short. But, you know, there's a lot of fresh air. And they were around their kids. And they actually, many of the Luddites were actually some of the best craftspeople of England in their time. They actually knew how to make clothing. They knew how to do all sorts of stuff. They had decent lives. But wealthy people figured out, powerful people figured out, that a lot more money could be made if we would take all these people who lived in all these sweet little villages and brought them into cities, let them live in lovely slums, and then put them to work in what Blake did refer to as the dark satanic mills. And so the Luddites had this interesting response to being dragged out of their pretty little villages and dragged out of their relatively functional economic existence and being put in a dark satanic mill where they might have the opportunity to work with their children next to their child who was chained to a machine. And their response was to break the machines. And they took as their hero a guy named Captain Swing, who famously could pick up a hammer and swing it loud enough to break an entire loom with one blow. That was a hero. And you know, the interesting thing about the Luddites too was they did not exactly respond to CEOs with the sort of, you know, let's give them a big bailout thing. They were more in the I welcome their hatred school. They would literally drag the owners of businesses out, put them on a platform, and try them for crimes against humanity. The British government did not take this well. And so at certain points during the early 1800s, when Britain was fighting against Napoleon, there were more British troops stationed in Lancashire than there were in major parts of Europe. Why? Because the British were freaked out by this, and it worked. They put down the Luddite rebellions, and the Industrial Revolution went forward. But the interesting thing about it is the great historian Dorothy Thompson, wife of E.P. Thompson, who I think we really bring to a new level in this book by saying that her research was as important or more important than her husband's. She researched the Luddites and what came of them. And you know what they did? They had been so disempowered, they were left on the fringes of all power. At night, on a full moon night, when it was light enough to go out and to make your way home and to find your way, they would gather on hilltops and, you know, in glens under the full moon and talk about their circumstance, talk about what had happened to them, what they had lost. They had to do this after having worked 12, 14, 16-hour days. They had to walk sometimes miles to do it. And yet they formed clubs across England. And they would just talk about their circumstance. Coffee houses became centers of discussion about these changes. Everyone was talking about it. Their first response was, can we figure out a way to get rid of the machines? You can't stop progress. You never can. Their second response, can we figure out a way to get rid of the people who own the machines? Well, people who own the machines have armies. And you know, it's very interesting that machinery always quickly aligns with military power. And so they were so disempowered. And it's a really dark and sad story until somebody came along and said, you know what the problem may be? It may be that we lack power. It may be that it isn't the technology. It isn't some individual or some political party. It's the fact that we're not a part of this. And so Dorothy Thompson traces the Luddite movement leading directly, ultimately, to the Chartist movement. The Chartist movement was a political reform movement that fought literally to the death in some circumstances. Violent struggle, not that the reformers were violent, but that they were literally mowed down. These were brutal battles at times. They fought for a set of constitutional reforms or political reforms. England didn't have a classic constitution that led to universal suffrage, that said elections had to be fair, you had to get rid of gerrymandered districts, all sorts of structural stuff that you would think of, well, that's just the boring stuff of elections. They fought for real parties and real representation. And they got beat once, they got beat again, they started to do reform acts and other things. They eventually got something akin to minimal democracy. And out of that began wild, radical changes. And you know what the interesting thing was? They started to fight to have the right to organize trade unions. They started to talk about something called an 8-hour day rather than an incredibly long day. The subject of child labor came up. The rules and structures, how a factory operated. They began to tame the radical changes of the Industrial Revolution via democracy. And it worked. They actually eventually even fought for the right to vote for women.
Wow.
I know. And you know what? You say, well, that's just the British and the Luddites. They must have been cooler than we thought. No. In the late 1890s in this country, as we moved from an agrarian society to an industrialized society, we had similar reactions. We had violent labor struggles. We had an incredibly intense push and pull about the mechanization of our society, about this movement from agrarian life to the slums of the cities. And the initial reactions were rough and very edgy, and then not so successful. But ultimately, we began to develop a progressive movement. That progressive movement said, you know, you need to make political reforms. We need an elected US Senate. We need votes for women. We need structural changes that begin to allow us to get to that table. And you know what the interesting thing was? When Franklin Roosevelt traveled to Green Bay, Wisconsin in 1934 to thank the progressive movement for the changes that had come, he said, you know, what you folks realized was that you need to have power. You need to be in the midst of this discourse if you are going to have any influence on your economic futures. This was something that Roosevelt taught, and Roosevelt gave speeches about machines and who owns the machines. We have lost massive amounts of history that tells us what we do in a circumstance like this. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, the future is going to be different than you expected. It's going to be more jarring, and we're looking at changes that really are amazing. John Maynard Keynes wrote about this back in the 1930s. He said, by 2030, we're going to be looking at massive loss of jobs, and we're going to have people really displaced. He said, you know what the big thing, the biggest change we're going to have to do? It's going to take us quite a bit of time, decades. We're going to have to figure out how to work less and enjoy our lives more. And it won't come easy. It won't come fast, but it will come. And I think Keynes was right. I think what he was proposing was true. But this is the bottom line reality. That's only going to come if we're at the table, if we're a part of it. The changes that are coming are revolutionary, but the only way that they're going to be good for all of us is if we have a revolutionary democracy.
He's clapping, right? So we had index cards handed out to take questions on, so I am going to throw one more question at John while we're collecting those, and you guys, if you can bring some up to me, I will, or Annalise is collecting cards. Lovely. And then, yeah. So, John,
yes.
Your book, you were telling me before that few months ago when you were finishing this book that people thought you guys were kind of exaggerating with this fascism stuff.
Yeah, I know. This is very interesting. This is like the best part of writing the book. We have a wonderful editor, and Alessandra, who's not here tonight from Nature Books, but we
Katie
turned in
is.
What?
But Katie is.
Katie is. Yes, we have fabulous comrades and friends. And so, anyways, we're writing this book, and we turned in the first draft of the book, and we said, you know, look, we've studied a lot of history. We understand how these changes play out. The one thing that's important to understand is that if you don't really improve your democracy rapidly when changes like this are taking place, you run the risk of moving toward authoritarianism. And that one of the dangers is that because of the destabilizing nature of the changes that are taking place, you may see the rise of political leaders who will propose authoritarian responses or very dark and hardcore responses that blame individuals and other groupings rather than looking at the core problem. And that the tension and the volatility of the time could, in fact, even in a functional democracy, or what we think of as a functional democracy, lead to fascism. And our editor was like, you know, guys, this is, you're sorry, you're talking, it's got a lot of, you're spending a lot of words on fascism here. That's a kind of, you know, come on, let's be realistic, right? And so we said, look, we do not want to do this to you, Alessandra. And she said, no, we need to talk about this some more. And we said, okay, you insist, we're going to give you Donald Trump. And what I would suggest to you right now is, I'm not calling Trump a fascist, other people can. What I will tell you is this, Trump's doing well today because of stuff we talked about at the start of this. He's doing well because there are people who see fundamental changes taking place in their lives that they feel they have no control over. And they feel they have been lied to by their political party and political parties in general. And you can see all their flaws, and they are on great display on a regular basis. But that's the bottom line of where a lot of these people are coming from. Similarly, Bernie Sanders is attracting crowds of people, and those people also are dramatically concerned about the future. Our crisis right now, and this is going to be an incredibly volatile year. It's going to get more volatile, not less. And our crisis right now is that we don't have a media and a political class that is talking about what people know is happening to them. That's right. Thank you, brother. And this is a point where knowledge is power, and lack of knowledge or lack of discussion is dangerous. Because if we don't talk about the big fundamental issues, you are going to see things get pulled in all sorts of directions. And people will start to blame one another, and we will end up with a politics that becomes darker and more dangerous. I promise you, if we don't bring these issues to the forefront quickly, and that's all of us, if we don't do that quickly, we will look back longingly to the stable and genteel election of 2016. And I leave you with one other notion here. This will unquestionably be, because these changes are coming so rapidly, there's no question, this will either be the last election of the 20th century or the first election of the 21st century. And tonight, you people have chosen to extract yourselves from watching the, you know, minute-by-minute coverage of whatever Donald Trump says.
Polls aren't closed yet.
No, but it doesn't matter. Trump will be saying something. And, you know,
Unfortunately.
No, but this is the reality of our circumstance. You've extracted yourself, but you'll come home and you'll get some results tonight. This is a pivotal, what? Yes, he's winning. Yeah. And he's, you know why he's winning? I'll tell you why he's winning. On Super Tuesday, I was at I do like really fun
Which
stuff.
Super Tuesday, the media's called them all Super Tuesday now.
No, there was
also Super Tuesday.
This is what you have wrong. This is Sarah, when you get to be a professional political journalist.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, then you'll understand that the first one was Super Tuesday.
This is Super Tuesday?
The second one was Super-er Tuesday. This is Superest Tuesday, and I don't know what comes next when Utah votes, but I was coming out, so I get to talk to nuns a lot. So I'm talking, and the nuns, but just the Jesuits, they love this discussion. Just wanted to let you know. So I'm talking Jesuits, nuns. I'm over at with the Catholics on Super Tuesday. I give my speech about all this stuff, and they're all a little bit depressed, but you know, hopeful, and because they believe in miracles and blah blah blah, and so. Anyways, so I'm talking to the nuns, and then I got to go do BBC's commentary on the American election, which is great and fun and cool. So I'm driving to the studio, and I think to myself, I'd better catch up on the results. So I have Sirius satellite radio in my car, and it's not a driverless car, but I got like a driverless radio, and And so I put on CNN, and I'm listening to CNN, because I've got like 15 minutes before the hourly break. I got about 25 minutes to get to where I got to go. So I'm driving along, and Trump is on. And I think to myself, oh, wow, I'm listening to Donald Trump. That's okay. I'll listen to a little of him, and then I'll get the results. And we come toward the 9 o'clock hour, right? And I'm thinking, okay, they're going to have to break now, and they're going to give me the results. No. Trump kept right on talking through the news break. And I'm thinking to myself, this is unbelievable. This is really the last stages, right? This is, you know, the horsemen of the apocalypse are going to be appearing any moment now, because we don't even tell you the results of the election. We just let the guy just keep on talking right through it. And so that's why he's winning. We're not paying attention to an election. We're paying attention to a guy. And it's always bad when you just pay attention to a guy.
So I have several questions that are on similar themes, which is great, because then we can get to more of them. So I've got two here that in some way are asking, so workers have gotten power and managed to win reforms in the past by striking in the workplace, by sometimes more or less disruptive and or even violent protest. In an automated world, where does workers' power come from? And in this moment, when we are seeing the rise of Trump, the lack of many, many people's interest in voting, what kinds of protests should we, will we see?
Well, the rise of Trump may get people interested in voting.
Getting some people interested in voting.
But there's also, look, we actually saw an interesting thing. We saw protests over the weekend in Chicago that were talked about a great deal. This is an interesting thing. This is, you know, our founders were pretty smart in some ways. One of the things they said was that they outlined a right to assemble and petition for the redress of grievances. They actually understood the concept of protest and that it was a part of a democratic infrastructure, democratic struggle. What happened in Chicago the other day forced a dialogue about Trump that was so significant that it is now, amazingly enough, entered into our media. And we actually have had, in the last few days, serious discussion about some of these issues. So protest has meaning in this thing. But the core of your question is the important one. How do you organize workers in a digitalized automated future? How do workers, you know, have a place in this? Well, one of the things that's fascinating, we write about this in the book, is there's massive organizing taking place right now. We're in a golden age of organizing and activism. It's just, if we had a media in this country that actually covered human beings, we would know that. But the fact of the matter is that we have these movements. And this is the interesting place. Some of them are already very visionary in this regard. There's a wonderful group in Seattle called the Transit Riders Union. And they're organizing not on the basis of where you work, because increasingly we don't have a place where we work. They're organizing on the basis of need, right? And what a great thing to organize on, right? That people who are in this new economy, this, you know, increasingly lower wage, unequal economy, right? They've got to get to jobs that don't pay them that much. If transportation is not accessible, if it's not very affordable or free, then their lives become much more difficult. So the Transit Riders Union is organizing everybody that uses mass transit in Seattle. It's a beautiful model, and it's working surprisingly well. In fact, you just mentioned Shama Sawant. The Transit Riders Union had a slate of candidates in the last election, and their candidates won a lot of the major elections in Seattle. And so they're actually, in many ways, mimicking all of the realities of a traditional trade union, only doing it on the basis of need. I think we're going to see a lot of this develop, and I think it's a great concept. But one thing I'm going to counsel on, we must maintain, trade unions are going to be more necessary, not less, in the future. And what we have to understand is first principles are going to become incredibly significant in this regard. Here's one of the things that we read a lot about. In the fast food industry, there's tons of reports on the point at which workers demand a level of pay that makes it sensible to begin to automate, right? And one of the great pressures against the 15 in a union movement will be the threat of automation. You would literally say to workers, you know, we start to pay you that level, it's cheaper to replace you with a machine.
I get a lot of tweets that say that every time I'm tweeting at a fast food protest, in fact. A lot of people go, well, they're just going to replace them with robots anyway.
Well, this is, in fact, we actually chart in the book, this is happening. There's actually in a lot of places. And so then you say, well, should we say then, oh, well, I guess people that work 40 hours a week, you know, shouldn't be able to get out of poverty, right? Because we have this practical reality. Wrong. You know, we have to come into this new age with first principles that Yes, nobody should work 40 hours a week without a living wage, enough wages to get out of poverty. And if that level of work can't be made available, if that does not exist, then we have to figure out ways so that those who do work, maybe for fewer hours, get a sufficient recompense that they can survive. I mean, this is, now how we do that, and we write a lot about this, but oh, there's tons of ways to do it. Yeah, you're responsible. I'm sorry, mister. You don't get to say, oh, I hope Eugene Victor Debs will lead me out of this thing. You know, because as Debs rightly said, if I could lead you into paradise, I wouldn't do it because somebody else could lead you out. And so the bottom line on this, though, is we're going to come into a lot of fights, and power is going to tell us that our only option is to let them do more of what they're doing. So they will say, well, you know what? We really would love to pay fast food workers more, but if we did, we'd have to automate. Well, we need to debate about that. We need to have serious thinking about that, and we actually have to ponder whether that's a good idea. And if it is a good idea, then what are we going to do for those people that now don't have those jobs or have a lesser job? And that's number one. But here's another one that power will say. I promise you this. They're going to say, you know what a really good way to create a bunch of jobs is? Let's burn the planet, right? And I promise you, this will be the response. It'll be, you know, global warming, we accept global warming now. We denied it for a long time, but now we accept it. The problem is that it really is going to cost us jobs. So let's burn the planet, right? Now, our response has to be to look at what Bob Pollan and other people have said about a green economy and the jobs that come from that. And we just have to be ahead of the curve. And people that tend to be ahead of the curve in that way are trade unions. But our trade unions, our trade unions have to evolve to this moment. Some of them are, some of them are not. But I'm going to tell you, the fact of the matter is, need-based organizing will be the organizing of the 21st century, not necessarily workplace organizing.
So, well, you just touched on a question that I have in several forms in front of me, which is, how does the problem of climate change fit into this picture?
Well, Naomi Klein is a great influence to us. In fact, when we were writing the book, we actually suggested that for our working title on it was, "This Changes Everything Else." because, of course, Naomi Klein is right. This does change everything. In her book, it was a brilliant book, and she talked about how the way that we're going to begin to deal with all of the climate challenges that we have is to understand that this is related to capitalism, it's related to economic structure, it's related to politics. And, you know, we have to see political solutions and economic solutions beyond just environmental. We have to expand our definition of all sorts of words. Well, the same is true with the change in work life. And what we suggest is that the danger of a clash between people who are facing a lot of downward mobility and people who are saying we have to save the planet is something we have to avoid. And the future on this is going to be a solidarity politics. And people are going to have to hoop themselves together on these issues. That's not going to be easy because there are going to be transition periods where there are an immense amount of lies and an immense amount of basically attempts to profit off the changes that are taking place. This is where the collapse of our media becomes such a fundamental issue. Because the truth of the matter is, just as our democracy is not sufficient to deal with the changes that are taking place, our media is radically insufficient to the changes that are taking place. And so, you know, we could go on, and we write about this a lot in the book, but what I would just say at the simplest level is that we're coming into a place where credible, stable information from sources we can trust, it's going to become more important rather than less. And so part of one of the things that we're doing with the book is that as we've toured the country, we have, you know, with the help of local people, chosen media outlets and communities across this country that we think are visionary and that are engaged with these issues. And each night that we've been in a city across this country, we've done a fundraiser for a media outlet. And so in Madison, where we began, we worked with WORT, a brilliant community radio station that really is exploring work life. My friend Adam Benedetto has been associated with it. In Seattle, we worked with Yes Magazine, and we had a big event with Yes Magazine, which is an incredibly optimistic and visionary magazine that's looking at this, and they're looking at all sorts of structural responses that they can start to get ahead of this. What we want to do is, frankly, develop a web of communications in this country about these issues and about optimistic and functional responses to them, so that as these changes come, people have places to turn that they can really trust isn't going to give them, frankly, the big lie of the moment, and rather see us through to a place where we're actually starting to work together. We're going to need that so desperately, and I hate to, you know, bounce back to my media reform roots, but
don't hate.
This is a really big, big deal. Is our media is not gonna get us out of this as we have it now. And so part of what we demand is not just an economy that's functional, not just a politics that's functional, but a media that's functional.
So I just got the 5-minute sign, which means this is my last question to throw at you, which means I've got 5 index cards here that I'm going to try to combine into one, because let's see how good I am at this. So I basically have a bunch of questions that all boil down to the famous, what is to be done? What can we do to push us forward into the post-work future? What can we do for people who feel left behind when they're unemployed? What can we do to reach people who are voting for Donald Trump without, you know, failing? And what are some resources for people who want to work on all of that?
Okay, great set of questions, and we can bring them. You know, we could always do the subject's classic response to this is pick your favorite question, and. You know, what we can do, and I won't just do this, but what we can do with folks who are supporting Donald Trump is to try and understand why they're supporting him. And this is a place where I think a lot of our media has failed. Not all media. When I criticize media, I want to tell you I'm a part of it, and I love what some people are doing. And I celebrate those who really do a great job. I happen to think that the New Yorker magazine does an excellent job on some of these issues. And we have friends.
These may or may not be affected by who is in the audience.
No. It's truthfully. But what I'll tell you is that overall the media system, you know, doesn't. And we have to really understand. I've been to the Trump rallies. I've been to Trump's headquarters. I took my daughter to Trump's headquarters. She got a T-shirt. But she somehow figured out that you could put Bernie Sanders' name in a key place, and somehow it read differently. And so the bottom line is that being mad at Trump is a good idea. Being upset by what his supporters do is a very good idea. However, failing to understand why people are drawn to this, that's a really bad mistake. And to think that they are simply all the worst people or all this or all, don't do that. Look at this reality of this incredibly volatile year. Ask yourself what's going on and figure out, you know, in some ways how to talk to these folks. But also, even if you cannot talk to them, figure out how to talk to their kids and their grandchildren, because this volatility is real, and we got to get serious about it. Now, yet another. What was your other? There's a great.
We had which?
What then is to be done? Of course, I always forget that. look, one of the things that people suggest is that we need a universal income, you know, universal guaranteed income, and that as you move into a moment like this, guaranteeing some amount of, you know, basic income to people, that's a way out of it. That idea was very, very popular in the 60s and 70s when the first wave of automation came in and people were really anticipating where we were headed. Bob and I argue for immense caution in that regard, because if we're displacing millions of people and then we say, well, here's what you get in return for, you know, a functional, stable work life, a little bit of money, right, enough to kind of just squeak by, and maybe if Paul Ryan has his way, voucherized, right, that you can do it in vouchers to buy a little bit of healthcare or something like that. But if that's our answer, then our organizing in the 21st century will be for $4 more on the universal income, right? Our future will be to say, oh, well, we have all these people that are surviving. It's all they've got. We've got to get them $4 more. We've got to get them $11 more, right? We've got to index it to the cost of living. And that's not bad. I'm all for making sure that people get enough to survive. But that's not an organizing that's going to get us out of this thing. What we have to do is, and this is, I mean, sorry if you want to answer. You want to answer? Okay. We're going to have a social welfare state. Sorry. We're just going to have to do that. And we're going to have universal health care. It's going to be single payer, Medicare for all health care. I'm sorry what some of the politicians say this year. That's not. It's not debatable. If you have a gig economy and people are trying to piece together a life, right, they're not going to be able to afford even the nice little systems that have been developed in Obamacare. It's just not going to work. And
I
so
can barely afford Obamacare.
That's what I'm saying. We're going to have to do single-payer Medicare for all health care. And you know what the weird thing about it is? When these changes start to come on, it isn't going to be that hard to get it, because we're going to see if we say, oh, we don't want to just buy people off with a voucher or something like that. We want a functional system. And as people in the middle class and even in upper class start to feel these pressures, we think a single-payer healthcare system is going to be a pretty easy one to get. We also think that free transportation and a host of other things that people in other countries have, We absolutely are going to have them, not because they're things that we like. It is because they are the only functional structural response to the changes that are taking place. So those of us who advocate for those things should restructure our advocacy. Instead of saying this is what we want because it's humane, this is what we want because it's decent, this is what we want because it's good, we should be saying this is what we have to get through this moment that we are in right now. We need to lock our humane and idealistic activism in with practical responses to what will be, for a lot of people, a crisis moment. And the last thing I'll say is that in the close of the book, we work a lot with people around this country that are already deep into the response. One of our heroes is Gar Alperovitz. Gar was a Senate aide, then he went and taught at the University of Maryland. And he had roots in the industrial Midwest, in fact, in Racine, Wisconsin. But Gar decided that, you know, there are places that are being fully abandoned by our industries and by our corporations. And so he decided to start developing models for putting people to work in the most abandoned places in America. And some of his work in Cleveland is absolutely visionary. He's literally developing whole new industries. And the interesting thing is, they're entirely owned by the people who live there. The whole point is worker ownership. And the whole point is having people work less, not more, for a decent living. We highlight companies across this country that are worker-owned and that are, in some cases, on the cutting edge of technological change. Only the interesting thing is they're making the technological change so that people come out ahead and benefit. And we were with a robotification place, which is worker-owned, and this is the incredible thing that they're doing. They're bringing in, they sponsor all the robot clubs at the schools. And they're saying, yeah, come on in here and see what we can do with this automated future that is to benefit us, not just to put somebody out of a job. There are incredible things happening right now. And cities across this country are beginning to move their economic development money away from begging some multinational corporation to come and put 4 jobs there and starting to create economic development funds that are all about local worker ownership. And you know who's one of the mayor of New York, Bill de Blasio, has actually been pretty good on this, although our city of Madison, Wisconsin, is in the cutting edge lead of this, and they have actually now put millions of dollars into it. They've developed some incredible companies, and the best thing of all is that we close the book off with Rebecca Kemble, who's a cab driver in Madison, Wisconsin. She fought Uber with everything she could, and has had quite a bit of success in fighting to keep decent unionized cab jobs in a worker-owned cab collective. She now is the head of the National Coalition of Worker-Owned Operations and Industries and Businesses across this country. And this spring, she ran for the city council and got elected in Madison. She is now implementing one of the cutting-edge models for developing a new economy in which workers and people in a community are taking hold of the technological changes and making them benefit us, not benefit a handful of people who we will never meet. The bottom line is this: radical changes are coming. They are guaranteed. The answer to those radical changes is not to try and stop them, not to try and just get all angry and frustrated or depressed. The answer is to say, we have to all become Rebecca Kemble. We have to fight the changes that we think are wrong for us, and then we have to get incredibly involved politically, and we have to seize the means of political production so that we can begin to take our great wealth and put it to use for the great mass of humanity. We can win our future, but I promise you, no one will win it for you. You have to do it. People, get ready.
Thank you, everyone. I think John is going to be signing books if you would like to buy them over at this table, or if you would like to argue with him further. I'm sure he's happy to do that, too. Thank you all for coming.